nothing more we can do. Well, it wasn't through. I've never seen a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow, but I've got a promise I can hold in the middle of the struggle. God, if you said it, you'll perform it. May not be how I want you to, but here's what I'll do. I'm gonna wait on you. I'm gonna wait on you. I've tasted your goodness. I'm trusting your promise. I'm gonna wait on you. Yes, I'm gonna wait on you. I've tasted your goodness. I'm trusting your promise. I'm gonna
Well, good morning, everybody. Can we give Jesus Christ a hand clap of praise this morning? Let's all stand to our feet. Go ahead and give him one more clap and a shout of praise. Is he good to you? Do you love and appreciate the Lord this morning? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Good to see you all in the house of God. You may be seated this morning. And good to see you all in the house. And got y'all, didn't I? That's good. A little exercise. Amen. Wake up. I'm trying to wake up, too. We went and had football yesterday and kickball for family day, and we are just about wore out, and I am not 4 or 5 years old no more, so and the weight is not good at all, praise the Lord. So I got a few announcements this morning. We got some more people coming on in. I'm so glad you chose this house to worship in this morning. You could have went anywhere else this morning, but I'm glad Calvary's Cross was on your mind, and I'm glad God directed you here this morning. Amen. I want you to get all you can from the service. Put all you can in, and I believe God is a God that still blesses. Amen? He's a God that still delivers and heals and saves. So I got a few announcements today. The Children's Christmas is coming up very soon. I believe Sister Morgan has organized that, and it's a great burden here at the church. We love to do it, and we have so many needs, not only in this house, but outside the four walls. And God has blessed us to be able to do that again this year. So we need $200 more dollars to meet the goal. And I believe my wife said that is to buy the presents for the kids. So we need $200 more dollars. If anybody wants to do that, you can give online through the apps or here live in the house. Do that as well. So $200, I believe God will meet that today. I believe that. Amen. We are in a parade. Our church is going to be in a parade, and we are so excited. Yeah, go ahead. Amen. We are so excited. So here are the dates. Okay, listen. December 3rd is the Rossville Parade. That is the parade that the live praise and worship band will be on the parade playing live music and singing praises unto God. Amen? And you'll be walking with us and meeting people, loving on people. And I thank Brother Frank for letting us use his trailer this year. Let us do that. Amen? Thank you, Brother Frank. And December 11th is the Chickamauga Parade. So December 3rd is Rossville. December 11th is Chickamauga. The sign-up sheets are in the back. We are collecting candy for that. So if you got anybody wants to bring candy for that need, please do that. We'd love to pass out candy, pass out some flyers, and pretty much just have fun and enjoy Christmas together as family. Amen? As a church body. How many knows we need each other through this time? Amen? Well, I love my church family. I do. I really do. Sunday, November 28th, p.m. service. Now listen, we are uniting with another church again. God has blessed us. I don't know what's happening, but I love how God is moving with our church body. We are going right down the road. If you go to the stop sign this way, all the way down the road to the left, there's a little church in the holler there, in the hole. That is Carpenter's Church. Brother Dwight Sanders has asked us to come lead praise and worship, and also I'll be preaching that night. So our church is going to move right over there to that church. I promise it's 2 minutes away from the church. It is a great on fire for God church. They have a vision to see unity like Pastor's been preaching about, has a vision for. God has allowed us for another church to move into and to unite together to have service. Amen. So November 28th, that's the last Sunday of this month. We won't be here. We will be there. Service starts at 6:30. Somebody say 6:30. 6:30, all right? Last but not least, Thanksgiving is coming up very, very, very soon. I can't believe it's almost December already. Amen. Thanksgiving and Vision Night is tonight. Amen. Can we give God a hand clap of praise for that? Thanksgiving food, meeting with our fellow members and the family. So no service tonight, just Thanksgiving dinner. If you got a family member, I've been doing this yesterday. Bring some family in with us. Bring lost people you know in. Let's just have a good old time with dinner and fellowship and celebrate Thanksgiving together. Also, it's our vision night. So I don't know how Pastor wants to do it yet, but we'll be have vision night tonight and Thanksgiving dinner at 5 p.m. So the time does not change, 5 p.m. Last but not least, your leadership forms are due today. They were due last Sunday, but because we had so much stuff going on, I didn't get to do mine last Sunday, but I got it done this morning. Sister Katie got hers done. There's plenty more, I believe, back on the poster board back there. Grab you a sheet if you're in leadership. Fill it out for Pastor. Just an accountability sheet to let us know how you're doing, if you need any help, how we can pray and keep up to date what God is wanting to do. Because God has a big plan for this house, and we got to be on track. Somebody said we got to be on track. Amen. So I appreciate you this morning. Let's stand this morning and get ready to give in our tithes and offering. And I'm excited for Pastor's new series this morning. Amen. On an appeal to heaven. I'm looking forward to hearing what God has to say to the church. And you know what? If you really open your ears to what Pastor says a lot of times, a lot of things go over our head. And a lot of things we just don't want to listen to. I'll be honest sometimes. Amen. But we really need to listen to this morning because he's giving me a little insight on what he's preaching on. And I believe God is going to speak to the body this morning. Because how many knows there's a word for the world, but there's also a word for the body. Yeah. Amen? So let's remember this morning. Remember Pastor as he preaches and the band as we sing and play. If you got your offering, hold it up to God this morning. If you don't have nothing to give, just give yourself. Amen? Father, we love you. We adore you. We praise you, God. We thank you for your wonderful spirit in this house, God. Father, I pray you would break every stronghold, God. Deliver every person that is in captivity, God. I pray for their offering this morning, God, that you would meet the need of everything that we need in this house, God. Father, we are a church that is without lack, and we believe that you are a God that will sustain us in this time, God. Lord, we look to you for every answer. We look to you for every need, Father, and I give you everything I have this morning, God, in myself, Lord. Remove us, Lord, from our fleshly ways and put your spirit inside of us this morning. Morning, God, that we can be good stewards of your money, of your tithes, and of our time here at the church, God. I pray you bless the worship, bless the offering, bless the word, and we give you all this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Bring your offering forward. As you do that, give Jesus Christ one more hand clap of praise and greet your neighbor this morning. Amen. Hallelujah. Do you love him this morning? I said, do you love him this morning? Amen. How many knows he's your everything you need? Everything you ever wanted, everything you need, he is that everything. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's go, guys. Well, some have made Jesus a game that they play, to others a song that they sing. Oh, but since I met Jesus, I'm happy now to say, to me he's become everything. Oh, to me he's become everything. Well, he's everything that I need. Well, he's the beginning, let me in. He's life's dearest friend. To me, he's become everything. One more time. Oh, to me, he's become everything. Well, he's everything that I need. Well, he's the beginning and the end. He's life's dearest friend. To me, he's become everything. Listen, you know some have made Jesus just a game that they play. To others, he's just another song they sing. Oh, but since I met Jesus, I'm happy now to say, to me, he's become everything. Woo! Well, to me, he's become everything. Oh, he's everything that I need. He's the beginning and the end. He's life's dearest friend. To me, he's become everything. Put those hands together for me. Yeah. Is he your everything this morning? Glory. Listen. Well, when I wake up each morning, he's right by my side. At night, he's my last thought in mind. You see, he's joy for each moment. He's hope that faith brings. To me, he's become everything. Oh, to me, he's become everything. Well, he's everything that I need. He's the beginning and the end. He's life's dearest friend. To me, he's become everything. Listen, well, when I wake up each morning, he's right by my side. At night, he's my last thought in mind. You see, he's joy for each moment. He's hope that faith brings. To me, he's become everything. Sing it with me. Well, to me, he's become everything. You believe that? Well, he's everything that I need. He's the beginning and the end. He's the life's dearest friend. To me, he's become everything. One more time. To me, he's become everything. Woo! Well, he's everything that I need. He's the beginning and the end. He's the life's dearest friend. To me, he's become everything. I believe he's my doctor, he's my lawyer, he's my best friend, he's my bread when I'm hungry. Glory to God. I love and appreciate him. Turn that one beside you, say, he's my everything this morning. Hallelujah. Out on the water, storms raging high, the waters around them, they were troubled that night. Fear filled their hearts, and they thought they would die. They failed to remember that the Master was nigh. He spoke the words, and the winds all stood still. calm their storms, just like He will mine, if I just remember that He lives deep inside. Why should I worry? Why should I fear when the very same Jesus is always so near? He lives in my heart and He hears when I cry. I can call on His name till the storm passes by. We serve a great big God that knows everything you're facing, amen? Hallelujah. Just give it all to Him this morning. Let me know He's able. Woo! I love this verse. We read in the Bible, when He walked with me, He brought light to their darkness when the way grew so dim. How great it would be to have His footsteps in mine and to walk with the Master all of the time. And when trials come and death is so nigh, listen, I'll just call on my Master. I know He'll get there on time. And when I'm in trouble and my body's in pain, you see all I have to do is just call on His name. Why should I worry? Why should I fear when the very same Jesus is always so near? Hallelujah. And He hears when I cry. I can call on His, woo, glory to God. I believe that. Oh, why should I worry? Oh, why should I fear when the very same Jesus is always so near? He lives in my heart and He hears when I cry. I can call on passes by. Hey. He's always so near. He lives in my heart and He hears when I cry. I can call on His name till the storm passes by. Just call on His name till the storm passes by. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Can we give Him a clap and a shout of praise? Thank you this morning. He's always there. He always listens. He always cares. There's nobody like Jesus. I said there's nobody like Jesus. There's nobody like Him. I've looked high, I've looked low. I've went to many different resources, but I never found no more happiness than I've ever found in Jesus. He's always there. Sister Ethel, don't we know that, honey? Come on, somebody testify that. He's always been there. No matter how far you try to run, no matter what you're going through or try to hide, I'm glad He sees right through us this morning. Some stuff I'm afraid that He sees. Come on, somebody. But I'm glad He's faithful through it all. I just want to sing that chorus. I'm going to move home, and I want to sing that chorus for somebody. Through it all. I've learned to trust in Jesus I've learned. Somebody needs this morning. Oh, through it all, through it all, I've learned to depend upon His word. Just one more time, just like that. Through it all, through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. Through it all, through it all, I've learned to depend upon His word. Yes, I've learned to depend upon His word. Let's praise Him this morning, church. Come on now. Glory. And how great is our God. Sing with me. How great is our God. Come on, church. And all will see how great, how great is our God. Sing it out this morning, yes. Oh, how great is our God. Oh, sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty. All the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps Himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at His voice, trembles at His voice. How great is our God. Oh, sing with me. How great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. To age He stands, and time is in His hands. He's the beginning and the end, the beginning and the end. I love this. The Godhead, three in one. He's the Father, Spirit, Son. He's the Lion and the Lamb. He's the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, how great is our God. Oh, sing with me. How great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. Lift our hands this morning and sing this chorus one more time. How great. Come on. Come on, church. Is our God. Sing it to me. Is our God. And all will see how great. How great. Is our God. One more time. Lift up your hands and sing it today. Oh, how great is our God. Oh, sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. I love this part, listen. Oh, he's the name above all names. He is worthy of our praise. And my heart will sing how great is our God. Sing that with me this morning. Name above all names. Well, he's the name above all names. That chorus one more time. Oh, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great. Let him know how great he is this morning. He's a good God. Oh, we'll see how great. How great. Glory to God is our God.
Better than that. I said, how many is faithful this morning? We serve the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I couldn't help while he was singing that song and he was beginning to sing, how great is our God. How many this morning, when we think about how good God is and how great God is, that we can go back to a place and time when we were undeserving and unworthy of God's love, and when we were in a place of destruction, in a place of demise, where I felt, God, where can I go from here? Is there anybody ever been there this morning? Lord, I've tried to make the right decisions. Lord, I've tried to stand on the word of truth, but only to come to this place where I feel beaten and I feel discouraged, where I feel I can't even lift my hands, Lord. It's in that place where I'm thinking, God, where are you in the middle of all this? Right. But how many is thankful that the Bible said that whosoever call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved? How many knows that David said, for I look to where my help comes? Hebrews said Jesus is the author and the finisher of my faith. Can I tell you, when I'm surrounded, when I feel I don't know what I'm going to do, the Bible said greater is he that is in me, that is in the world. That when I change my perception, what I change of what I've been looking to, something begins to stir. And I'm believing this morning that there's something that is beginning to stir in this house. How many knows that you might have walked in heavy burden, but when you begin to raise your hands and just surrender and worship, you felt that burden begin to lift up? So I wish before we move forward, somebody lift up your voice and give the Lord a hand clap of praise and a shout in this house. Oh, come on, somebody praise him in this house. I wish somebody know that it said he inhabits the praise of his people. I wish you would go ahead and invite God into your mess this morning. I might have been messed up, tore up, but when I lifted up my name to Jesus, The Holy Spirit invaded my atmosphere. I wish somebody praised him in this house. Tap somebody, said, I feel my help this morning. I wish somebody tap your neighbor and say, I feel my help this morning. How many knows that whenever you begin to praise him? David said, when I praise him, he inhabits. And when he inhabits, that means he surrounds where you're at. See, some of us right now keep on wondering why you're surrounded by all the heartache and all the mess. Well, a good starting place is learning to praise God in the bad time, the good time. See, everybody thinks that praise is just your shout and all that, but how many of those are seven different words of praise in Hebrew? There is also sometimes you gotta bow, sometimes lift your hands, sometimes you shout, sometimes you gotta bend over. Those are all the same word of praise. And see, I don't know about you, I can praise him while I'm bowing down and praying and say, God, I need you more than what I need that's coming next. But see, we got to understand that when we think praise, we only think about when we shout and do a chicken dance. I ain't in prayer with your chicken dance or a shout. I need somebody to touch heaven this morning, because the Bible said that when I praise him, he said he inhabits my praise. And the Bible said where the presence of the Lord is, there's liberty. Can I tell you, if you can run and shout and there ain't shackles falling down, you better check the way you're praising, because God sometimes ain't impressed with the shout or how you can do your chicken dance. He wants to know if you can bow down on an altar and say, there's a name above all name, and God, let me step out of the way for a minute, cause I need to touch heaven this morning. I wish somebody use your key and bind every assignment of the enemy. Use your key and loose heaven in this atmosphere. I got any key turners in this house? I got any midnight praiser? I wish somebody lift up your voice. Use your key and let heaven loosen this. Amen. How many's ready to start this series this morning?
Amen.
We got a few. I said, how many's ready to start this series this morning?
Amen.
I tell you, I've been doing a lot of studying over the last, I guess it's been a while really, and the Lord kind of gave me the release to finally to begin to come into this series that we're going to be talking about, an appeal to heaven. It's a lot of rich content in it. I believe it's going to be open up our eyes and enlightenment and truth to where we are in this day and hour. And there's a lot of information that you will learn in this series, and it's amazing how schools don't even teach about this anymore. How many prior to coming into this service has ever heard an appeal to heaven or seen an appeal to heaven flag? Nobody. That's interesting. The appeal of heaven actually was part of our founding principles in this country. It was actually what George Washington flew in Delaware. It was the building principles of this nation. We often know the famous slogans like, give me liberty or give me death. We've heard of all this. And the appeal of heaven faces in that same category of this. It was a basic understanding of it. We'll just kind of get into it. So basically, an appeal of heaven during the 17th century, there was a series of conflict in Britain between Parliament and the Crown. And this caused British scholars to think and write a great deal about the nature of government and the limits of royal power. John Locke, in 1632 to 1704, was the most important of these political philosophers. In 1689 and 90, he published the Second Treatise of Government, which says, where the body of the people or any single man is deprived of their rights or is under the exercise of a power without right and have no appeal on earth, then they have liberty to appeal to heaven. Whenever they judge the cause of a sufficient moment. The quote is part of Locke's justification for the overthrow of the British King James II, who was removed from the power in 1688, an event known as the Glorious Revolution. Locke's appeal to heaven is not about prayer, it's about a direct political action. Lot argues that people have rights that cannot be infringed upon by the government, and that rebellion is justified if it is to defend those rights. And as American colonists increasingly came into conflict with the British government during the 1760s and 1770s, Locke's words became an inspiration to many patriots. After all, if the glorious revolution was justified as defense against tyranny, didn't the American Revolution have such some justification? The slogan, "An appeal to heaven," is less dramatic than "Give me liberty or give me death," but in its own way, it is equally forceful and evocative. It is a call to action couched in the words of the philosopher rather than a politician. When we read "An Appeal to Heaven," the first thing we understand is that the appeal to heaven came that when people were under subjection, that rights were being infringed. That the tyranny of Britain had came to such a place that they felt above the law, that they were subject, and all we were subjects to them. And in this place, if you know King James II, King James actually wrote the Bible, got it translated into the English translation that we all read now. Well, his son was not a very nice dude. He believed that kings had divine authority, that they were not subject unto law, and really caused a lot of mess. But in the midst of that, that's where the philosophers begin to say that when we no longer have any earthly appeals, that when man has let us down, then we have a right and the authority to appeal to heaven. And this was a major point that I want you to understand, that when we understand an appeal to heaven and how this country came about, the Revolutionary War was not combative about people that just all of a sudden grabbed guns and got mad. The Revolutionary War and what sparked the movement started in a pulpit. It started that when men of God began to preach that who the Son set free is free indeed. There's liberty where the Lord is. Begin to preach crazy things like liberty. And how many knows that your adversary don't want you to know that there's liberty in the Lord? See, the enemy wants to keep us bound to certain ideologies and certain thoughts, but how many knows that we're not part of ideologies or government or white, black? If we're Baptist Church of God, we have the liberty of the kingdom of God and by a man named Jesus. And see, when we begin to understand this, the church no longer leans if it's Democratic, Republican, unvaccinated, vaccinated, mass, non-mass, black, yellow, white, Baptist, Church of God. We're no longer identified by these things, but we're identified by blood bought, filled with the Holy Ghost, under one kingdom, one umbrella that says, who be in Christ be a new creation, that there be no Jew nor Gentile in the kingdom, but brothers and sisters in Christ. But how does the enemy keep the church from understanding its authority? He keeps us divided, because how many knows that a word that the Bible said, a house divided cannot stand. See, we don't have to have enemy armies charging after people, because as long as people are divided and cannot come in agreement, there ain't no way you're going to take back a country for the kingdom. Because all we're doing is we're fighting one another. We're saying, well, you're part of this clique. You're part of this clique. You voted this way. You voted that way. I don't agree with what you're saying. Can I tell you, let bygones be bygones. We can all come in agreement and know that Jesus is the Son of God, that he died for me, and that whosoever believe on him would have everlasting life. And I tell you, if we're so worried about who's Republican, Democratic, if you got the shot, did you get the shot, do you need to wear a mask, do you not need to wear a mask, that's silly talk. That's how the enemy's keeping a kingdom of God divided. But when a church has enough and says, I don't care if you got a shot, don't got a shot, wear a mask, if you're Republican, Democratic, if you like Biden, if you wish it was still Trump, all I know is I served a king that still sitting on a throne, that he didn't have to be voted for, that I didn't have to worry about a voting machine. I don't have to worry if it's true or if it's not true, because it was blood bought on a cross that said it is finished. And every time an enemy wants to say, is Jesus really the Savior, just go to Jerusalem and find you an empty tomb that said, the God that I serve, I don't have to vote in, because it was birthed and paid for by, oh, somebody better hear it this morning. But the enemy has us appealing to different things. You ever hear that? Well, if we'll ever do this and we see this, this nation's going to change. And I tell you, it don't matter who you vote in office, how it swings, if the house goes back red or if the house goes blue, that ain't going to turn the nation around. What's going to turn it around when the church says it can be blue or red, it can be whatever it wants to be. But when a church says, I'm not getting confused by who's in office or who's in there, we'll just keep on worshiping Jesus, keep on coming in agreement. And I tell you, it will start shifting the atmosphere. It will start shifting the outcome. It's time for a church to stop looking to earthly means and start having appeals to heaven. We need some old-fashioned prayer meetings. We need to come back in agreement and know that if we get in alignment where any two or three are gathered in thy name, then he is in the midst of it. Can I tell you, there was 182,000 troops that came up against one angel and they could not beat them. Can I tell you, the Bible said, bands of angels go all around you. When the church gets on fire for God, I don't care if it's China, the United States, Russia, whatever army wants to come against you, it will not accomplish against the army of God. But the army has to stand up and know what we're appealing to. God cannot move in a divided house. A church has to come back in agreement to who we're appealing to. There was a quote that I really liked from Kevin Wallace. I like Kevin Wallace. He gave a good quote, and I wrote it down. It said, "The pew is weak when the pulpit is confused. The pew is weak when the pulpit is confused." Can I tell you, we live in a day and time that we have a lot of confusion coming off some pulpits. Either way. And I tell you, this isn't the time for ministers to be leaning one way or the other. That's what the enemy wants. I don't care if you're far right, far left. Are you centered? Yeah, that's going to get it. And I tell you, we come to a place, that's why Jesus was in the middle. He wasn't on the right side or the left side. He's in the middle. We ain't got time to be extremists one way or the other. You need to be extreme for Jesus. Because why is this? Because as long as we're confused off pulpits, you got certain pulpits preaching that the vaccine's the mark of the beast. I'm just going to call it out this morning. You got some people saying that if you get the vaccine or you do this and that, let me tell you, your own personal conviction, that's yours. But I'd be more rather focused on, are you seeking after Jesus in this day and time? Because can I tell you, there is a deception that is sweeping this land. And if we don't get rooted in the Word of God again and appealing to the kingdom of God, we are in trouble. Because I know, let me tell you, I don't know. I got my own personal beliefs, but I ain't going to spew it off a pulpit. Because why is that? You need to see Jesus rather than what I want to say. Because don't let my attitude or what I want deter you from knowing a man named Jesus. If we will come into this place and understanding that we all have our own thoughts and our own ideas, but there's one thing that we can all come in agreement and begin to appeal to, and that is Jesus is the Savior of our lives. And we have to come to that thing. There's a lot of different things and different motives in the church. And let me tell you, that's fine. Everybody got personalities and everybody got their own thing. I'm not trying to call you be you boo-boo. You know what I'm saying? But I'm going to look unto Jesus. When we come into the house, we shouldn't be gossiping about what you think's going on or this going on. We need to hit our knees and ask Jesus, what do you want me to do in this hour? God, don't let my attitude get in the way that I won't go spread the gospel to somebody because of their skin color, if they're vaccinated, unvaccinated, if they're Church of God Baptist. Lord, just let me put my stomping shoes on and tell them about a man named Jesus. The Bible said there'll come a time that nation will turn against nation. Kingdoms will turn against kingdom. The Bible didn't say that'd be all right. He said, he that endureth to the end shall be saved, and this gospel be preached. And I tell you, God ain't looking for a generation that can throw stones at Democrat. God ain't looking for a generation that can stone on Republican. You better shake back and understand you are falling under deception. But when it says I'm not looking left or right, my eyes are set on Jesus, cause I'm appealing to heaven. I'm done with your tricks. I'm done with your deception. Cause if I keep on looking under Jesus, he said, greater is he that is in me, that is in the world, that already overcame it. And I tell you, there's something inside of you. If you'll put your eyes back on Jesus, COVID ain't got a chance. If you'll put your eyes back on Jesus, abortion won't be in this nation again. We got to be some godly living people raised up for the kingdom again. Stop talking about how they're killing babies. What are you going to do? Stand up and take a stance and say no more in this country. We talk about how we need to end racism, but yet you can't go talk to somebody if they look different and you sit on down. It's time to take authority and be action and representation. The church spends more time talking about how hell's broke loose rather than storming hell and saying, but the gates of hell shall not prevail. I'm going to come back and take what the devil stole. We got people that want to do different chants in their church. Shame on you. You ought to be saying Jesus in your church. I'm here to tell you, if you're growing a church off a secular chant and secular thing, that ain't what the kingdom's about. You need to show them a man named Jesus and say, no more am I appealing to ideology of man. I'm appealing under the authority of the kingdom of God. Matthew 24, verse 3 and 8. I have to give you scripture here. I feel this thing. It said, and as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be? Talking about the end of times. And what shall be the signs of thy coming and the end of the world? And Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you. Take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you be not troubled. I mean, this morning can say, you ain't going to catch me troubled in this hour. Come on, I got some saints up in here. That you be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. A lot of us thinking, Lord, I'm waiting for the flying by, but look at your neighbor and say, the end ain't yet. It ain't over yet, because why? There's a work to do still. It said, but the end is not yet, for nation shall rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilence and earthquakes in divers places. All these are the beginning of sorrow. Look at your neighbor and say, it ain't over. It's just the beginning. Let me tell you, some of us right now fretting, acting crazy, but look at your neighbor and say, this is just the beginning of this roller coaster. Can I tell you, you better get it right at the beginning before you find yourself fall down at the wayside. The church needs to understand we need to get back to our heritage and not be worrying if it's the donkey or the elephant. I'm just going to fly an appeal to heaven and take my stand. Now, when we understand kingdom against kingdom and nation against nation, when we know nation, that translation in the Greek is race against race. Jesus begins to explain the steps and what the enemy's going to work in. What was the first deception? How many knows you can't be laid astray unless you can first be deceived, naive. It doesn't say that people be coming in the name of the devil and coming in this. They said that he gonna come in my name. He's going to come in the name of Jesus and begin preaching. How do we know the deception? If any man's not preaching that who be in Christ is a new creation, if people are not preaching that all are created equal under God, that means you're no greater, no better, no lesser. We are all equal under the weight of God. If anybody starts saying, well, you got to be far this way and far that way, my Bible said narrow is the way and few are going to make it. We need a generation that's not getting hung up on politics, but rather be the politics. tactics of the kingdom and change the motive, change the situation. But see, how is the enemy going to deceive? He's going to sow discord, then deception. Deception will begin to come. It tells us that there would be deception that become. Many are going to begin to claim things and begin to lead us astray by our ideologies and off our earthly perspectives. How many can say you can catch yourself leaning to certain ways by what your earthly secular perception is right now? There's a lot of us in that. I've been there. I have my own personal beliefs. But more than any, what's my kingdom belief? How am I going to stand? Because can I tell you, God so loved the world. He loved the whole world. But there's something that's moving that the church has to realize. We're not facing people. You're not facing a political party. You're facing a principality. You're facing a spirit that's moved among this nation. But if we don't wake up now, we're in trouble. We're in big trouble. It tells us that there'll be famines. How many knows inflation? You can go to a grocery store and understand real quick, inflation's real. Just the beginning. Pestilence. How many knows we've had pestilence here lately? Strand after strand, different things at that. Pestilence. Bible, Jesus told us this in Matthew 24, what's to come. But the church is acting crazy. This should have been your moment to triumph and be above the cause, showing the right way, showing the light, being a city on the hill. It tells us that famines and earthquakes in divers places. How many knows right now, anybody been keeping up with the Canary Islands and La Palma? That earthquake's been going on for, 9 weeks, 55 days straight. That they're saying possibility that the earth, that the fault line can break off and the rock will fall in the ocean causing a tsunami. Hello, Revelations is unfolding in our eyes right now. But a church is so caught up on the earthly, secular things rather than getting ready for what God has called us to be. Now, when we understand where we're at, if we go to Revelation 12, verse 9 and 12, it tells us, and the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceived the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation and the strength and the kingdom of our God. And the power of Christ, for the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. How many knows that if you look at the church right now, it seems like there's accusation after accusation that has come against believing people of God. That the cancel culture is real. Y'all gonna be honest up in here. Cancel culture is real. And can I tell you, if you bite into cancel culture, it's only a matter of time before your culture will get canceled. Because there will always be an offense. But somebody got to take and stand. You can cancel all this, but you can't cancel Jesus. How many knows you can't cancel the truth? The truth will prevail. Can I tell you, that's why I said the heavens and the earth shall fade, but the word shall stand the test of time. I believe in that scripture in Matthew. Matthew was just telling us how it's going to be. There'll come such a time they'll so be caught up in their cell and they'll be thinking, where is the church? They'll be canceling everything. They'll say, oh, that, I don't like that. You can't say that, for you know it. They won't have nothing to watch. They'll keep you locked up in a room, not talking to nobody, not fellowshipping with nobody. How's why? The Bible said there is power when people come together in fellowship. Recognize the attack of the enemy. Right now it seems like, well, let's cancel that and we're all happy with that and we're shouting, but before you know it, God will they will cancel every avenue. You'll only watch what government wants you to watch. They'll keep you so padded up and so scared to walk out of your house, you'll be sitting in deception thinking, where are you, God, the whole time? But if you'll ever snap back and realize, they can cancel all the things they want, but they can't cancel the word of God, because the word shall prevail. And I tell you, there's power in agreement. The Bible said, do not forsake the fellowship. And I tell you, Amendment 1 in the Constitution said, I have the freedom of my speech and the freedom to gather and worship. And I tell you, there's people that want to hang on Amendment 1. I can say whatever I want, but they want to tell the church they can't worship. Bind that devil to hell. That's part of Amendment 1. The church needs to know its rights again and stand up in authority. Don't let the enemy take from you because you're so deceived, looking left to right, but you better recognize the attack and what the enemy's doing. But the enemy right now has got us so caught up in the things, and before you know it, they'll say, you know what? No church can be on social media. Because they'll say, you're a hate cause. Why is that? Because we believe in such a thing as holy living, and we ain't compromising. You'll find out who the church is or who's in it for hashtags and likes. Before you know it, you'll say, we can't say the name of Jesus. We say God and everybody's happy. I don't know about you. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man come unto the Father but through me. I don't care if you just say God all the time and God this and God that. If you don't say that name of Jesus that was given unto him above all name, you better learn to start saying that name, Jesus, Yeshua. Let me hear you. Somebody better just say Jesus up in this house. How's what the world wants you to do? You just say God and be happy. How's guess what, Muhammad? You can say God and they'll be happy. The Catholics be happy. All this be happy. I ain't here to make people happy. I'm here to transform and be a city on the hill. I'm here to show you heaven and appeal to heaven's coming for out of this generation. I'm not afraid to say that name Jesus, but are you? It'll come to a time that they'll say, you can have church as long as you don't say Jesus, as long as you don't preach on things that are sin. You make them feel good. Last time I checked, the church ain't a seminar and a motivational speaking class. The church is meant to make known sin. The church is meant to say, if you don't clean your act up, you're bound to hell. Church is meant not to let you grow complacent in your life, but bring you out of yourself and say, who be in Christ, be a new creation. And I tell, there's not a better you. Yourself sucks. You need Jesus. Can I tell you, you were born in the sin and by the Father of wrath. And I tell you, you weren't born bougified and the best thing ever. You need Jesus today to enter into the kingdom. But it said that the serpent was cast out. And it goes on to say that he gonna make war. It's gonna be terrible. Terrible. It said the accuser day and night. He's on our heels. Let your neighbor say, he's on the hills. He's on our hills day and night. But 11 says, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. The blood of the Lamb. And by the word of their testimony. And they loved not their lives unto death. Therefore, rejoice, ye heaven and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil has come down unto you, having great wrath, because what? He knoweth that he had but a short time. And I tell you why the devil's running rapid, why the devil's in your home, why the devil's trying to get in the church, why the devil wants you to get offended, why the devil wants you to think, well, I like this way, and they ain't right. I don't believe in that. Why is the devil working overtime right now? Because the Bible said his time is short. You better look at your neighbor and say, his time is short. And I tell you, he's running loose in the church. He's running loose in your family. Because why? He knows he's got a short time to try you to pull you down, because it's just a number of days, a number of times, for he's going to split the eastern sky, that every knee shall confess, that every knee shall bow, that Jesus is the King and the Lord. I don't know about you, but I'm not worried about 2024. I'm worried about tomorrow, because tomorrow could be today at the trumpet sound. But will you hear the trumpet, or are you worried about the trump? I'm here to tell you, there's only one trumpet I care about, and that's when he's going to sound the alarm at all of heaven. Heaven's going to know Jesus is back, and the devil served his notice. This ain't popular preaching, but appeal to heaven. It wasn't about political. It wasn't about the colonists. It wasn't about colonial. Can I tell you the reason they came to America is where they could worship God. If you know what was going on, King Henry had started a thing of the Church of England. He was going around acting like a donkey, but they were Puritans that had came in separatism. That was a movement that come out of Martin Luther. Nobody knows about them when he knocked on the door and hung the thesis statement unto the Church of England that started Puritan. That's what we all are. We all come off the very basis of Puritan religion. But what happened, they were coming under subjection, and what happened was you had some within that tried to reform the church. You had the reformers that were working within the Church of England. You had the separatisms, which were the ones that went on their way. And guess what they came on? The Mayflower. This nation wasn't birthed out of, oh, I want to do this. They were just wanting to worship God. Can I tell you, God birthed this country, and God's going to renew this country. But the church has got to wake up. The church wasn't built on what side of the fence you were on, what political side you were on. All they brought with them was an appeal to heaven that said, no man accepts when my earthly rights have been gone. I've been under tyranny, but who the Son set free, there's liberty in Him. If I can make my way across that sea, I promise God, we're going to worship You in spirit and truth, that there be no bondman, there ain't black, white, yellow. All we want to do is be able to lift that name of Jesus. But the church is so messed up, tore up, that all we can do is argue about who's politically correct, who knows this and who knows that. I don't know about you. I just got to know that I know Jesus. Because if I don't know Him, I don't know about you. But it don't matter how much knowledge, revelation you got. If you don't know Jesus, been washed in the blood, a renewing of the heart, a right heart, you'll find yourself. But we got to understand that the enemy is working overtime right now. And the church talks about all these different things and different this. When's the church going to start raising back up? When's the church going to realize it's not your party system, it's the kingdom system? And I tell you, there's no votes in the kingdom. We get tore up. We spend more time voting about everything in the church rather than praying about it in the church. And I tell you, you ain't got to vote something when you're in unity and you all hear from the same spirit. You'll flow. But until a church learns how to appeal to heaven, then there'll always be some donkey that wants to pull a different way than you. Can I tell you, the church needs to learn. We don't come to church to congregate and to talk about things. We come to church to magnify Jesus. We can all agree about it. I don't care if you're Baptist church, God speaking tongues, what you are. We can all agree we need to lift that name Jesus in this day and time. We spend so much time talking about, are you filled with the Holy Ghost? Do you speak in tongues? Can I tell you, if you are filled with the Holy Ghost, that's great. You need the Holy Ghost. But certain people believe you get the Holy Ghost as soon as you're saved. And guess what? It said without the Spirit of God, you can't be saved. So when you get saved, guess what you got? The Holy Ghost. But what happens is his baptism is submerged. That means you get more and more in the Spirit, and more of the Spirit becomes out of you. And I tell you, you can rattle tongues and ain't got one fruit of the Spirit. That ain't being filled with the Holy Ghost. That's been knowing how to rattle tongue. But when you're filled with the Holy Ghost, there's fruit that comes off of you. That's fruit of the Spirit. Do we need to go to Galatians chapter 6 that tells you the fruit of the Spirit? Long suffering, love, kindness, and meekness, humbleness. And I tell you, there's so many people speaking in tongues, so haughty and prideful, and they want to act like they're the best thing since Kenneth Copeland, the best thing since that. And I tell you, you ain't filled with the Holy Ghost, you're filled with your attitude. Your grandpa taught you how to rattle some tongue. Your grandpa taught you how to dance and want to talk about, oh, I know how to move heaven. No, you don't, because there's still things laid up in your church that if you were anointed like you said you were, called like you said you were, calling on the right name like you said you were, there's liberty in the presence. We live in a day and time now that we want to blame the devil why things are running in the church. I beg a differ. You better take some ownership in the church. Get on your knees and start appealing to heaven, because when the anointing's in the room, the devil can't sit in the room. When the anointing's in the room, you can't gossip, because why is that? The Spirit in me is greater than the attitude in you. It has to come subjection under the weight of the cross. If it's time for the church to stop being pacified and appealing to all these different things, congregating, politicking in the church, let's just raise up an appeal to heaven and come in one mind and one accord. And I guarantee you, devils can't sit where the kingdom of God is. He already got cast out of that kingdom already. So if the devil can sit in what you call kingdom of four, authority. Last I checked, God kicked him out of the kingdom authority. It's time for the church to raise back up. But we spend more time dividing. You spirit filled? You speak in tongues? Last I checked, speaking in tongues ain't going to get you to heaven. Well, I'm going to tell you. That's the evidence of it. That don't mean you got it. Acts 1:8 said that you shall receive the power of the Holy Ghost and power and be a witness. Can I tell you that some people speaking in tongues and you can't even go to a grocery store and hand out a tract, but you say you're filled with the Holy Ghost. Last I checked, Acts 1:8 said that when you get the Holy Ghost, you'll want to be a witness that will compel you into the mission field. There's a lot of us saying, I'm filled with the Holy Ghost, and the only place you want to be a witness is on a pulpit when you can say, look how powerful I am. I can raise them up and shout. That don't move me. What's last time you went out in the mission field? When's the last time you prayed for somebody at work? Let me tell you, when you get filled with the Holy Ghost, drunk on the Holy Ghost, it ain't just a holy run and holy speaking in tongues. Guess what you'll do? You'll walk into church and somebody will tell you, my aunt's sick. You'll stop right there and say, in the name of Jesus, by his stripes you heal. When you get filled with the Holy Ghost, I don't care if you're at work, church, wherever you're at, you'll pray right on an instant. You'll bind that devil just like you would on Sunday. And some of us are wondering why you can't pray and why you can't break through. God ain't waiting on you to get to church on Sunday to start praying. He said, you are the church. I filled you with power, and you can pray right then and move heaven. That's nonsense. We're talking about peeling to heaven, and we got a church more worried about rolling around on the ground and saying, that shows we're intoxicated. That don't mean you're intoxicated. Show me you're intoxicated when it goes outside that church room. I don't care if you laid up for 12 hours in a church, and if you walk right back out to church and can't witness to nobody, you're just acting like all the church people and felt real good. And I tell you, you can get drunk at a Garth Brooks concert and fall on the ground and wake up with a hangover. But when you get drunk on the Spirit and the new wine, guess what? I can go to sleep at 1 a.m., wake up at 3 a.m. and feel refreshed in body and ready to tell somebody about what a mighty God we serve. It's time for the church to be the church and know that the power of God you got ain't meant for you to huck and buck and shove. It's meant for you to go run devils out of community, stone pale and say, but there's a new kind of flag being raised, an appeal to heaven's coming forth. I bet you them colonist boys weren't walking around saying, I bet who can speak in tongues. They said, we got power, and who, if God be for us, then who can be against it? And you imagine when the army's battling their drums and betting at them, and the army of the colonists, a bunch of farmers pitchforks, but all of a sudden got guns. Why was that? Because there was kingdom authority that was coming with them. And I tell you, if the church will understand the authority again, got on some people right there. I'm telling you, the Holy Ghost will move. It'll knock you on the ground. It'll do some stuff. But if you ain't witnessing outside of these four walls, I ain't impressed with that. I don't know about you. I'm tired of seeing people jumping up and down, shaking, and then being the same old donkey acting self as soon as they go out of church. That don't impress me much. I want to see God get a hold of you, wreck you from the inside out, that you're the biggest witness in Rossville, Georgia. You're the biggest witness in Tennessee, biggest witness in your work. If I was to go to your work, how many people would tell them that you tell them about Jesus? If I go to your school, are you telling them about Jesus? Or do you only want to talk about Jesus when it's cool to talk about Jesus? But can I tell you, when the time comes, it won't be mainstream Christianity anymore. You'll have to hide out in places. You'll have to worship undercover. I wonder who will be left when the end time really comes. Will you be left? Everybody, it's cool to be a Christian right now, because why? You ain't getting persecuted for it. But you're going to show up when they say if you go to church, you're going to go to jail. Where's your Holy Ghost now? Oh, Jesus. But we have a time that's sure. It's time for the church to let bygones be bygones. It's time for the church to begin to appeal unto heaven and know that we have a kingdom authority that is behind us by the word that will validate us. But a church has to come in unity and agreement. Bible tells us in Romans 1:16. It says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone. Everyone. Look at your neighbor, say everyone. Everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also the Greek. We got a lot of people that say, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. How many could say, you're not ashamed of the gospel? Now, how often do you tell somebody about the gospel? If we're going to appeal to heaven, we got to pick up the word again. A true heart of evangelism. How often now will you pray at a place other than church? How often will you say the name of Jesus other than church? How often will you actually lay hands on somebody other than church? When will somebody get that Holy Ghost authority that says, I bind you in the name of Jesus, other than church, other than your clique? We need a move. The real deal. True blue. Church of God, Holy Ghost feel move. But somewhere along the way, we've been domesticated. As long as you're in your four walls, hitting your tongues, running the church, talking about unity amongst yourselves, guess what? God is moving. You're already saved. I shouldn't have to keep on trying to win you. We need to go out and get the harvest. When you talk about Holy Ghost filled, you shouldn't have to get one back to Jesus every Sunday. You should have a Holy Ghost that'll keep you with Jesus. Nah, that's it. How can you appeal to heaven when you don't even know if you're part of heaven? How can you appeal to heaven when you're serving two masters? I don't know about you, but the Bible said a man can't serve two masters. Man. Bible said a double-minded man is unstable in his ways. Some of you need to make your mind up. Who are you? You evangelist or you pastor? You a teacher or you an evangelist? Are you saved or you lost? Are you white or you black or you blood-bought filled with the Holy Ghost? But a double-minded man is unstable in his way. It can come down to the simplicity of things. Who are you in Christ? As that man knows, if you don't know who you are, you'll never be stable. Y'all listening out there? If you don't know who you are in God and what He's called you to be, you are unstable. And if you're unstable, then how can you stand on the foundation of truth? Ephesians 6, 10 and 18 tells us, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principality and against powers and against the rulers of darkness of this world and against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take ye the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand the evil of the day, having done all to stand. Therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod in the preparation of the gospel of peace, above all, taking the shield of faith, where ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all preservation and supplication for all saints. Why is it important that we're not ashamed of the gospel? Because without the word, we're defenseless. Without the word of God, we're defenseless. We have to raise back up into that place. The Bible tells you, if my word abides in you, ask and it shall be given. It's one thing to know the word, but are you living by the word? How do you know the difference between somebody that knows the word and living by the word? That if you live by the word, you operate in the authority of the word. You can't expect to operate in the authority of something you don't walk in. 1 John 5, 7 says, for there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Spirit. There has to be an alignment to be a bear witness. the first step for a church to come back into an appeal to heaven, to be in that place, a church has to get back in alignment with God. That's why David says, search me and find me, God. Know all my wickedness, but don't remove thy anointing. And how do I know that we in trouble? Because we're not operating in authority. Can I tell you that the disciples and the apostles in the old day, they operated in 100% effective. If they laid hands on the sick, they recovered. Every prophetic, every word God gave them was 100% accuracy. Why was that? They abided and walked in the principles of the word. But we get ourselves wondering if I'm scriptural or am I spiritual. You cannot be more spiritual than you are scriptural. And you cannot be more spiritual than you are scriptural. So when we think about this, if you claim to be super spiritual, but you don't know no word, we have to come to the place that the church needs to learn the word again. What runs devils out of rooms? The word. Is there anybody, be honest up here, when you get like your mind on you and your mind's troubled, you can start quoting the word. For the Lord has given me a sound mind, not of fear, but of power and love of Jesus Christ. When all hell breaks loose around you, you can say, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. This is the heritage of the righteous. And every tongue that rises against me then shall be condemned by the Lord. Uh-oh. You better watch who you're talking about. Bible said you better be careful if you're talking about one of his. He says every tongue that rises against you, he said the Lord shall condemn it. You ain't got to do it. Bible says that. When we talk about our heritage, some of us think about, Lord, am I ever going to get a leg up? He said you're the head and not the tail. When we start knowing our scripture, we got a remedy for the situation. But how can a church rise up in this day and time when we don't know the word and the remedy of this time? How many preachers know the book of Revelation? Know the signs of the end. And we wonder why we got a generation that don't know where they're at or the season they're at. How somewhere along the line the pulpits got weak and rather preach you happy on Sunday rather than equipping you for the battle that's coming. But when we understand this, we got to know that it's time for a church. One, we got to get back in the word. We can't appeal to heaven without the word and walking in the word, the principles of the word. Because why is that? Because he begins to tell us that what you're fighting in this day and time, it's not Joe Biden. I just call it like it is. It ain't Donald Trump. It ain't Kevin MacArthur. It ain't Nancy Pelosi. It ain't Schumer. It ain't none of them. They're under the influence of a principality. That when a man begins to get haughty and want power, then that opens the door to a principality to override him. And how do I know that? The Bible says we don't wrestle against flesh and blood. I'm not wrestling against a man. I'm wrestling against a principality. I'm wrestling against a spiritual wickedness that's sitting in high places. And I tell you, Jesus loves Joe Biden. Jesus loves Donald Trump. He wants Joe Biden to go to heaven. He wants Chuck Schumer to go to heaven. But all we got is a church talking about how they're the worst thing ever. But the church has got to see past the flesh and blood, and realize there's something that's moving in this country, and that if a church would start praying and put on the word, you would run that thing out of Pennsylvania Avenue. But as long as the enemy's got you focused on the man, you're not realizing the one that's pulling the strings. The church has been deceived. As Jesus said that he would deceive many. That man can say, I've been deceived. You watching CNN, Fox, and all them, that's deception. Because one, it's just what I want to hear in my natural. It's time that the church start reading the Bible again. It's time for a church to start praying again and appealing to heaven. Fox ain't got the answer. CNN ain't got the answer. Guess what? If there ain't no good news going on, it don't sell. Nobody wants to watch the news to hear it. It's 56 degrees today with a chance of clouds, and it's going to rain. The highways are good traffic today. And the government did a bill today. It was 45, 46. Everything's good. That don't sell. People are like, So they got to make it interesting. They got to say, well, Donald Trump's wanting to kill and do this, and he's a racist, white supremacist. They got to sell on things, because why is that? As long as they keep on preaching that narrative, you'll have black folks not want to be with white folk. You'll have white folk that are mad at black folk, and they want to play this device thing, and then they say, well, vaccinated, unvaccinated. They got us so messed up from the chest up that we can't even pray for one another, because we're looking at one another and be like, I wonder if they're like that. Who'd you vote for? You don't know Jesus. You don't know that. And I tell you, you need to put that crap down, put your Bible back on, and say, my God said there would come a time that nation would rise against nation, and bless God, I'm going to stand on the word. Because the Bible said it ain't a Republican, Democrat thing. It's a Jesus thing. It ain't a Joe Biden problem. It's a spiritual problem. And the only way you run a spirit out is with the spirit. You can't fight something in the natural and expect to run out something supernatural. Because the Bible said, my weapon's not carnal, but mighty through God and pulling down stronghold. When the church puts back on the word and the church starts appealing to heaven, you'll pull down strongholds out of your generation. You'll pull it down in the White House. But as long as you're sitting in your little kumbaya pity party, I'm a Republican, RNC, DNC, I'm Joe Biden, you're Donald Trump, I'm white, I'm black, I like Baptist, I like Church of God, guess what you are? You're in your own little kumbaya circle, not making no difference or moving heaven. Because the last I checked, God don't look at two different altars. He's looking for one unified altar. Before Elijah ever got the rain and before the fire ever came, he said, you got to repair the altar. I never meant for it to be southern or northern Israel. It's Israel, God's redeemed, one unified tribe under God. But we got the Baptist altar over here, the black altar over here, Republican way over here, unvaccinated over here, and we're wondering why God can't wreck a country, because the altar is broken. It's time for the church to repair the altar, get back between the porches and the altar and weeping, and lift up the sign to heaven and say, God, heal our nation. But we can't heal a nation until why we still divided. Kingdom against kingdom, nation against nation. Yeah, church against church. It's a sad thing when you can go to camp meetings and pastors won't even talk to pastors. Just walk on by. Then they get up on their pulpit and say, we got to unify and lock arms. Preaching a message you don't believe. Why? We're divided. We ain't no threat to the devil. Because why? House divided, king stand. He got you right where you want. Got us fighting each other. Arguing with each other over nonsense. I tell you, Jesus said it gonna happen. But who's going to endure it? Who's going to see past the trick? The smoke and mirror. This is a spiritual warfare. How many knows that? This is a spiritual warfare. They're after your babies. They're after your kids. They're after your worship. They're after all of it. And it's not going to stop. We have to set aside political thoughts and come back under kingdom authority and reign. Be ye separate as I am. Don't play to the motive. Don't be one that advances the enemy's agenda. And I tell you, I'm just going to say it like it is. Do you know the church is advancing the enemy's agenda more than CNN and Fox? Every Sunday, it's the most segregated day in the country. And here's a church praying for unity. It's got to stop now. A church has got to raise up. A church has got to put the armor back on and see past what this is. And it tells us, how do we stay that? We got to stay in prayer. You shouldn't wait till Wednesday night prayer meeting to be praying for unity and God to move. You got to stay in prayer. We have no endurance in the church anymore. We have no ump about us. We done got koshered. Nobody judges you. Nobody afflicts you. I'm happy. There's 150 different churches in Rossville alone. If I don't like the way you preach, I just go somewhere else and go to church. I don't like that. I'm going to go to this church. Got a bunch of goats. Time to get some sheep up in here. Time to raise up. Get planted. You want God to move in your home? First plant somewhere and start pressing. That's the problem. We ain't got nobody willing to get planted to transform where you're at. If you don't like where you're at, I'll just go somewhere else. And you wonder why you can't even transform your home or transform your workplace? You can't even do it in your local church where everybody says they believe in Jesus. I'm waiting for somebody to raise up and say, I recognize the attack of the enemy. Hell might break loose, but God called me here. I ain't moving. Devil, you got to go. We need people to raise up with that authority, but we ain't got authority in the church. Until it can start in the church, don't be mad you can't move it out of a White House. I'm going to be honest up in here. We can't even move principalities out of your local church, and you're wondering why you can't move it at a government level. You got to learn to get planted in your church. Ministers got to know what you're called to be. You got to know what you're here for. You got to stand on something. You got to make up your mind, get loyal to the cause, and say, as for me and my house, we're going to serve God. You can't be killing babies and me expect me to be fine with you. You can't be this way and this way, and I'm not going to tell you that God says that's all right. God loves you, but sin will send you to hell. You got to have somebody raise back up and stand on what is true and say, I'm not moving because some donkey principality is pressing against me to back up, but the river in me will flood that thing right out of the church. Somebody got to make up their mind and stand on it. You got to stand on what God has said. You got to be willing to endure and fight and push. Your heart's got to get right. Souls are at stake. This isn't a game. This isn't a... I don't think people realize the urgency. If you'd realize the urgency of what is going on, you wouldn't be gossiping after church. You'd be praying. Because if you ain't going to pray, who's going to pray? If you ain't going to stand, who's going to stand? You could be that one that starts the movement. We can take comfort at knowing that says, he that suffered with me reigns with me. I'm not here to tell you that the moment you decide to fight and the moment you begin to peel heaven that it's going to be easy. No, I'm going to tell you all hell going to break loose to test your word. Family members acting crazy. It's real. I know it's real. But he said that the present suffer is not even worthy or comparable to the glory which shall be revealed in you. But we can't never get to the glory in you moment because the first paper cut, you sit down. But when's the moment going to come that the church becomes the church? That's a question, ain't it? 2 Timothy verse 3, 16 and 17 tells us all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. This word that we have this morning, it's not just here to preach a good sermon. It's not just to look cute. It's for instruction, correction, reproving, and furnishing you this morning with the armor that it's going to take. As we sit here this morning and we come into this series of an appeal to heaven, and we begin to learn more history with it and some scripture to go. The first thing we got to understand that before we can ever appeal, first, we have to get right. We have to repent. Because why? Because we're divided. We turned against one another. We may not even realize it in some ways, because some of us have grown up under this bondage, grown up under these chains. But I believe we're living in a generation that God's called to be a chain-breaking generation. That the attack and the chain stops with you. But we can't do it on our own. We can't just put the flag up and say we're going to appeal to heaven and our hearts not get right. There's got to be a unified cause, a unified reason that a church raises up. And can I tell you, when the church puts Jesus back center in his house again, that all the other things, those are in the Bible and they're good. But if you don't know that man, Jesus, the rest of it don't matter. Now that's the only way we can go to the Father. I know there's spiritual blessings and there's spiritual gifts, and I'm thankful that we got them operating in this house. I thank you for the cloven tongue that falls like fire. I thank you for the authority, and I'm thankful for the Holy Ghost that reproves and makes known righteousness. But can I tell you, if you don't know the man Jesus, none of that can work. Because the Holy Spirit is sent in thy name to remind you of the word that I spoke. That we have to come back to a place that the church is no longer putting our political party, putting our race on, putting on my way of life where I grew up, but putting back on the word. That says we're all one under him. That when we come to a place that it's not about a Baptist church, Church of God church, the different argumental reasons we got in the church, but we just start coming in agreement that we come here for Jesus. How many this morning can say, I came here for Jesus this morning? Lord, I came to worship you in spirit and truth. Out of all of our different ideologies, and I'm thankful we got a diverse church. We got all kinds of different people in here, different beliefs. But there's one thing that unifies us all, that we can come in agreement that Jesus is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, that he is the Son of God, and that he's coming back. You know that he's coming back. That this isn't our end. This isn't the best it's going to be. He's coming back one day. And he's coming back real soon. And the church has better get ready and wake up. It's time to put the word back on. It's time to realize you're not right. You're not fighting your brother or your sister. You're not fighting a man. You're fighting spiritual warfare. And it's time for the church to learn how to fight in the spirit again. And the Bible said, for the sword of the spirit, which is the word. You have to fight with the word. And I'm believing God's raising up this generation. So this morning, my question to you is, as we started this series, how many this morning can say, Lord, I'm ready to make an appeal to heaven? If y'all come on now, how many said, Lord, I'm ready to make an appeal to heaven? Now, how many this morning can say, Lord, I've been carrying some chains, God, some ideology. I caught myself left to right this morning. But God, I'm ready to lay them chains down at an altar. Y'all better be right. I know I see a lot of us in here. So this morning I'm going to ask you, we all could be here. I want you to come to the altar this morning to pray. For those that are willing to be honest this morning, to say, Lord, I got some chains, but God, I want to lay them down. I want you to meet me right here. If you're ready to lay down your chains, God, and ready to put on the word, and ready to make an appeal to heaven, to be a unified body in this time that says, Lord, we're not going to get caught up in all this. But I'm going to look unto you, Jesus, because you're coming back to them. And I believe it with all my heart. So if you would, everybody stand this morning with every eye closed and every head bowed. As we begin.